Hi friends, welcome back to the channel. It's been a while since I've done a video. I don't know how to do this. What do I usually do with my hands? My name is Ash, I'm a cybersecurity enthusiast, and on today's video, we're going over another TryHackMe room, basics of Burp Suite. So we've got trusty TryHackMe booted up here. Now, this is one tool of many for web application penetration testing. All right, let's get into it. So let's start off with task one and boot up start machine. So this room is gonna show us what Burp Suite is, an overview of the tool, installing and setting it up, navigating, and some configuration. So that's all good. Let's complete that. Up our Kali Linux VM. It's been a little while.
First thing, gonna run an update. Yeah, probably should have done this before I started recording.
So as my VM updates, let's continue. We've got task two, getting started. What is Burp Suite? It's a framework written in Java, supposed to be a one-stop shop for web applications for pen testing. Also, can do mobile applications. And it's sort of become the industry standard. I know a lot of other YouTubers use Burp Suite who are in the web hacking scene, but there are other tools. It also translates almost perfectly for APIs. Simply, it can capture and manipulate traffic between an attacker and a web server. So us and what we're looking at. You can do like a bunch of other stuff. So like I have, and you will probably have, the community edition, which is free, but there's also the professional and the enterprise. So you can see a bunch of extra stuff that the professional has, and the enterprise has like continuous scanning and stuff. So let's go over our questions. Which edition of Burp Suite will we be using in this module? So that is the community edition. Which edition of Burp Suite runs on a server and provides constant scanning for target web apps? I'm gonna say enterprise. Cool, Burp Suite is frequently used when attacking web applications and what? The other one was mobile. Moving on to task three, still into getting started, features of Burp Community. It says here it has a relatively limited feature set, but is still superb. So we've got six tools inside Burp Suite. So Proxy, it's well known. This is for intercepting and modifying requests slash responses from us to web apps. The repeater allows us to do the same thing, but automatically repeat modified requests. Intruder, same sort of thing, but you can sort of spray endpoints, like doing more like brute force attacks or buzzing, trying to see if you get any response. And personally, those three I've used a lot in TryHackMe rooms. I haven't really gone over these three. So decoder is for decoding captured information or encoding a payload. And so that's interesting because I thought like you could still do that in the other tools. Comparer, comparing two pieces of data, either at the word or byte level. Yeah, so I'm not too familiar with that one. And then sequencer, which is for assessing randomness of tokens, such as session cookie values. Yeah, again, never use that. And you can also write extensions. So that's cool. Something else I haven't explored. So our questions for this one is, which Burp Suite feature allows us to intercept requests between ourselves and targets? So that was our first one. We've got Proxy. Next up, which Burp tool would we use if we wanted to brute force a login form? And that's gonna go over to Intruder. Lovely. All right, task four, still in getting started, installation. So if you're using the attack box on TryHackMe's network, then you should be good to go. It'll already be there. If you're using Kali Linux, you will have to go to Burp Suite's download page and install it. So follow the instructions there. I'll show you how to use it once my VM is updated. Ready, so I'm gonna go up to the start menu. What is it even called in Linux? Main menu? Your JRE appears to be version, so yeah. Okay, sweet. So Burp Suite opens next, start Burp Suite. So one thing is you can't like save projects in the community edition. Assuming you're a professional, you've got a client that you're working with on the web applications you're doing testing on. Yeah, like you would be able to save that off in the professional edition. You can't do that in community. Let's go on to task five, the dashboard. So we've just accepted terms and conditions, blah, 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 next. And we're greeted with the interface. I've got mine in dark mode. That's what it looks like, nice and dark. So there's four quadrants: tasks, issue activities, event logs, advisory. I'll be honest, I never really look at the dashboard. I just go straight over to target. The tasks, we can define background tasks. All right, the event log tells us what Burp Suite is doing. Honestly, that's probably good to come back to when you've like started. This issue activity, right, it even says pro version only. So I'm not even gonna use that. And advisory gives us more information about the vulnerabilities found.
That's something else that I should probably come back and use more. In Burp Suite, have a look around. Make sure that you're comfortable with it before moving on. To be honest, I don't think like you get that comfortable with it very soon, or at least especially the first time. It's like super overwhelming. But we'll move on. So next up, we've got navigation. So navigating around the GUI by default is done entirely using the top menu bars, target, proxy, intruder, repeater. So here's all the tools that we learned about in the other task. So we can detach tabs. It says there's a window tab. I can't see that. Might have changed. If you right click a tab, you can hide it or detach it. I never do that, but if that's something that you like doing, cool. There's also shortcuts, control shift, D, T, P, I, R for the corresponding tabs. Again, I never use them. Probably should. Control shift D. Control shift T. Okay, just doesn't work for me, so whatever. And then options. There's global settings, also user settings, and project settings. Which doesn't really matter for us because like, we can't save projects anyway. So unless you're forking out for professional, it doesn't really matter. So change Burp Suite theme to dark mode. Already done that. In which category can you find reference to a cookie jar? I don't know. Let's have a look. There is a search bar. Cookie jar. Sessions. Nailed it. In which base category can you find the updates subcategory, which controls Burp Suite update behavior? Updates. In suite. Awesome. What is the name of the subcategory which allows you to change the key bindings for shortcuts in Burp Suite? Key. Hotkeys. Lovely. If we have uploaded client-side TLS certificates, can we override these per project basis? A or nay? I... no idea. Search for this, then look at the scopes. TLS, override object options for this project only. Yeah, hey, we can. There are many more configuration options available. Take the time to read through them. Yeah, nah, I just want to get into hacking. I'm sure if I need to know about a setting in there, I'll look it up one day. All right, next category, proxy. Introduction to the Burp proxy. So this is the most fundamental and most important of the tools available in the suite. Right, capture requests. We know that. So for example, if we make a request to tryhackme.com. So what I like to do is go to target and open the Burp browser. You can do a whole proxy thing in another browser like Firefox. I just like using their inbuilt one. Cool. So we can see here that one request actually has a lot more. We're going to Vimeo for video, Google for analytics. Yeah, damn. So if we go to the proxy and actually follow instructions, we can turn the intercept on, and it's already picked up something from Hotjar. So we can forward that. We can just forward all these requests so that they actually get through on the browser. So Burp Suite just keeps popping back up anytime there's a request. So Hotjar is just making requests constantly. Kind of surprising. I can't even use Try Hack Me without turning this off. Crazy. Oh yeah. Okay. So it says we don't need to follow along, just read the information. So we'll do that. So yeah, bunch of information about the requests, all the headers, so what these are, and the term is hang. Like if a request is hanging, it doesn't actually go through until we hit like forward. So if I turn that back on and we just refresh the page. So here a request has come through and it's just hanging. And in fact, this is pretty much the same request in the example. And here we can right click anywhere and just go like send to repeater or send to intruder, or we can use those hotkeys also. And what's good is by default all the requests are going to be logged, so if you don't have intercept on and you didn't catch a request, like they'll all be there and you can just go back. And that's usually like when I think of the log, like I don't think on the dashboard, I think of this on the HTTP history. That's where I look. And this one's kind of interesting, the proxy specific options. So in the proxy settings, it's accessible by clicking proxy settings. So options gives us a lot of control over how the proxy operates. Yeah, interesting. So we can get more granular control. I've never used them, so I just leave it on default. All right, let's go through our questions. Which button would we choose to send an intercepted request to the target in Burp Proxy? So four? Yeah. Ooh, bit of research. What is the default keybind for this? So we actually did see that. Assuming you use Windows or Linux, swap command for control. So control plus R. No, that was to send to the repeater. Why don't we go to our options and look up the hotkeys, and then we can just search forward intercept proxies, control F. Mm. All right, next up, connecting through the proxy with FoxyProxy. Now, I'm going to skip this. If you want to do it, go ahead. I don't know if there's a benefit to using a third-party plugin and having multiple proxies. I have done this and you can do it, like in my opinion, just using the browser that's in Burp, so it kind of saves all the hassle of setting that up. But, you know, each to their own. To read through the options in the right-click menu. Oh, okay, I still have to read through everything. There is one particularly useful option that allows you to intercept and modify the response to your request. Oh, okay, maybe I don't. The option is in this drop-down sub-menu. I'm not really understanding the question. I think it's talking about when it's like, here you go thing. Is it like change request method? I think I have it based on character. I think it might be respond to this request. Spelled it wrong. Response to this request. Yeah, I never use that. It's kind of interesting. As a bonus, try installing FoxyProxy standard and have a look at the pattern matching features. I'm not using that, so I'm just gonna skip proxying HTTPS for task 10. If you're on the attack box, you can skip. That's fine. Great. So we can intercept HTTP traffic. What's next? Oh, yeah. So this is the other thing that is annoying with FoxyProxy and using that is you do have to go through this whole certificate thing. Not the end of the world. It's just a little annoying. Task 11, the Burp Suite browser. Now that's what I'm using. Yeah, okay. So they even say people tend to stick with their own browser as it gives more customability, but both are perfectly valid choices. That's good to know. I just think the browser's easier. All right. So using our built-in browser, make this request. And this is our VM that we've booted up. But we just need to get onto the network. Can't see the server, so let's go ahead and navigate over to it. I just turn that off. Just go to our history and we can see this request and response here, and we might just send that to the repeater. So here is our initial request and we can send that off and get our response. We can even see a rendering of it here, so that's cool. Otherwise we can get the headers and like the HTML, but now intercepts off, we can just see and browse it normally. And since we're using Burp Suite's browser, all of this, every time we go to a new page and everything, it's all gonna just keep showing up in this proxy HTTPS history here. Personally, like, I don't love the intercepts. Turning it on and off kind of feels a bit annoying. Like, you can just navigate to it and just go to the history. I don't know, each to your own. All right, next up, we've got scoping and targeting. So this is a good one. So we can, as we see here, we can right click a target and add that to a scope, meaning sort of like we sort of hone in on what we're actually like looking at. So the point of this is because it is tedious when Burp is just logging everything that we look at. Like, we saw a TryHackMe had all the different like third-party websites and apps that they have on like the website. So it's a lot. And yeah, that's why we use scoping. So we go over to the target tab, and here is that IP that I have. We can right click it and go add to scope, say sure. And honestly, sometimes I just like highlighting everything. We'll just go delete selected items. Don't want any of that. Just want to worry about this. And this is cool. There's a drop down and you have more of a visual of everything that you're seeing, like the file structure. Okay, that's kind of neat. But as you start clicking around, like, Burp's just gonna add all that. Or did it add all that automatically? I don't know. So this last thing here is proxy settings, proxy response insert, and URL is in target scope. So we're only targeting what's in scope. So we go scope settings. So we go tools, proxy, and here we've got and URL is in target scope. So I didn't need to delete everything with that, but I just like to. Is there a save, or that just saves automatically? And the point is seeing the difference, which I'll trust you, bro. Alrighty, next up is sitemap and issue definitions. Control of scope may be the most useful aspect of the target tab, but it's by no means the only use of this section of Burp. So there's the sitemap, the scope settings, which we just used, issue definitions. So this was the sitemap that I've just discovered, and I really like that. I definitely should have been using this. So every page that you visit will show up here, allowing us to automatically generate a sitemap for the target simply by browsing around the web app. Oh my goodness, why do I never use this? So the pro will also allow us to spider the targets automatically. Oh, that's cool. But to be honest, just like clicking around a basic like web app, you can find it all. And like, then you can just run your own tool for fuzzing. So it's not a big deal. Okay, so we don't have the vulnerability scanner, which we've mentioned, but we do have a list of vulnerabilities. The issue definition section gives us a huge list of web vulnerabilities, which we can have a draw from. Okay, so issue definition. Yeah, okay. I have definitely clicked into this tab and just not read anything. Yeah, this is cool. So take a look around the site. We'll be using this a lot throughout the module. Visit every page linked from the homepage, then check your sitemap. One endpoint should stand out as being very unusual. Visit this in your browser or use the response section in the sitemap entry for the endpoint. What is the flag you receive? Interesting. Well, found it. I know this is just a walkthrough. I just sort of expected a little difficulty. So I just clicked on this one because it was a random string and it was super unusual. And I could see in the response here that, we've got our flag there. Okay, not that challenging. Look through the issue definition list. What is the typical severity of a vulnerable JavaScript dependency? So we're looking for vulnerable, put that in alphabetical. Vulnerable JavaScript dependency is a low. So this uses third-party JavaScript libraries, which can introduce a range of DOM-based vulnerabilities, DOM, running in the browser, including some that can be used to hijack user accounts like DOM XSS. Interesting. I wonder if that's what happened to Linus Tech Tips. All right. Let's go low. Let's go over to almost the last part. We've got an example attack. Having looked at how to set up and configure our proxy, let's go through a simplified real world example. So we have a ticket page with a form that we can submit. So in the real world, a web app pen test, we would test this for a variety of things, one of which would be cross-site scripting or XSS. If you have not yet encountered XSS, it can be thought of as injecting a client-side script, usually JavaScript, into a web app in such a way that it executes. There are various kinds of XSS. The type that we are using here is referred to as reflected, as it only affects the person making a web request. Interesting. Okay, so we're going to use a HTML tag for script that allows us to put in this alert, and that is going to trigger the XSS. So we can do this through the contact email. So I'm going to go ahead and copy this. So you should find that there is a client-side filter in place, which prevents you from adding any social characters that aren't allowed email addresses. Let's go browser. Let's go over to the ticket, which isn't not actually specified anywhere. So we would have had to find that. That's not how you spell ticket. Cool. So, oh, okay, there you go. So there's the filter that it's talking about. So I'm pasting that in and it's just getting rid of it. So spaces aren't allowed. Makes sense. Okay, fortunately for us, client-side filters are absurdly easy to bypass. There are a variety of ways we could disable the script or just prevent it from loading in the first place. Interesting. Let's focus on simply bypassing the filter for now. First, make sure that your Burp proxy is active and that intercept is on. So let's go over to proxy. I'll select intercept is on. Great. Now enter some legitimate data in the support form. For example, pentester at example.thm as an email address and test the attack as query. So we'll go over here, we'll pop that in. That's accepted. And we'll go submit. Fill this out. Submit. And here we go. We get this response. So with the request captured in the proxy, we can now change the email field to be our very simple payload of the above that we had. As a paste payload, we need to select it and then URL encode it with control U. So we're replacing the email that we had, pasting it in, and then we're going to highlight it again and go control U. And that is going to see that difference URL encoded. It's such a handy hotkey, a shortcut to remember. All right, finally, press forward button to send the request. You should find that you get an alert with a successful attack. So that's the alert that is written in there. Let's forward that. Let's go back. Oh, we have another one. Forward. Success. Heck yeah. Congratulations, you bypassed the filter. Don't expect it to be quite that easy in real life, but this should hopefully give you an idea of the kind of situation which Burp proxy can be useful. Definitely. And that takes us to the end. That is the room conclusion. So there's more rooms to cover. Awesome. And that is totally the end. So thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to do all that YouTube stuff. I appreciate everyone's comments as I've been a little bit AFK for the past few weeks. So if you want to keep checking out the content, this is a video that YouTube has recommended just for you. Otherwise, thanks again, and I'll see you in the next video.